A study published in 2006, analysing the pacing patterns of almost every world record set in the men's 800 metre, mile, 5,000 and 10,000 metre races, showed how, for the three longer races, there is a consistent pattern. After a quick start, the record breakers settle into a steady pace until the final stages of the race. Then, even though their oxygen-starved muscles were presumably awash in a sea of fatigue-inducing metabolites, they accelerated. In all but one of the 66 world records in the 5,000 and 10,000 metres dating back to the early 1920s, the last kilometre was either the fastest of the race or the second fastest behind the opening kilometre. A similar phenomenon can be seen in the marathon too, and not just in the elites. In 2014, as part of an analysis of a massive dataset containing the finish times of more than 9 million marathoners from races around the world, spanning four decades, researchers found that the distribution of finishing times looks a bit like the classic bell-shaped curve, but with a set of spikes superimposed. Around every significant time barrier, 3 hours, 4 hours, 5 hours, there are far more finishers than you'd expect just below the barrier, and fewer than you'd expect just above. Similar but smaller spikes show up at half-hour intervals, and there are barely perceptible ripples, even at 10-minute increments. Only the brain can respond to abstract incentives like breaking 4 hours for an arbitrary distance like 26.2 miles. This idea that it is actually the brain that determines performance in a process of anticipatory regulation was first proposed in a 1998 paper by Professor Tim Noakes. In the paper, Noakes argued that the brain acts as a central governor, regulating performance to balance all the body's physiological systems. In this model, fatigue, or the slowing of pace, is the result of this regulation, which happens before any physiological failure can occur. In the central governor model, which is now more appropriately referred to as the model of anticipatory regulation, there are inputs and outputs. The inputs are provided by peripheral systems. These inputs act as afferent feedback to the brain, informing it of information like how hot it is, how sore are my muscles after yesterday's session, how much energy is available, what is the pH of the tissues, how hard is the heart working, and basically, is it safe to keep going at this pace? The brain integrates all this information and then evaluates it in the context of the exercise bout before controlling the system's outputs. In the anticipatory regulation model, the end spurt is the result of an increase in muscle activation controlled by the brain in response to numerous inputs during exercise. It occurs because the finish line is approaching and the physiological changes are no longer deemed harmful or potentially limiting to continuous exercise. The reserve can thus be activated. This doesn't mean that fatigue and the limits of performance are simply all in the mind. If your body ran out of oxygen, or its temperature went above 41 degrees, or if you did accumulate too much hydrogen in your cells, for example, these would have profound and dangerous physiological consequences.